SOAR is a nonprofit. We do wildlife rehabilitation, education, and research.
Yeah.
So the rehabilitation part, you guys know, we take in injured wild birds, we try to fix whatever's wrong with them, and release them back out into the wild. And so that part did not stop during COVID. That part got way busier because everyone was told, oh, it's safe to go outside, go take a hike. And so I think we had more input, more incoming patients, just because there were maybe more people were not sitting inside, you know, or going to ball games or the bar. Maybe in our town they were still going to the bar. They were out and hiking and being outside, which is great, and getting exposed to more wildlife. I think we saw more incoming patients during 2020 than we have in a long time, and it doesn't seem to have let up, and we're starting to do programs again, so it's been really nice. I stay home and cut up fish, Savannah goes to programs, and Lynette takes care of everything that involves any kind of technology. So I don't, you know, after cutting up fish, I just cannot open the computer. I can't do it. So
nice excuse.
She handles all of it. Yep. My fingers would be too dirty to handle. So I will try to send her videos and pictures and kind of update on what patients are coming and going. And so today I have a volunteer taking care of everyone back at SOAR, and she just texted me and said, I'm going to pick up another hatchier eagle. And so we have had 5 of them come in so far this year. And so we're still, they're not from here, but the babies are still needing a little help, a little assistance with some things. So we're still working on all of that. Some of the birds that we cannot release back into the wild, we have permits from the Fish and Wildlife Service, permits from the Iowa Department of Natural Resources to do the rehabilitation, and to keep some of our permanent education birds. And so I think we have maybe about 14 birds that are with us all the time to go to programs. And so we brought one of them with us today. It's the screech owl. Then that big crate. So no, we brought Decorah. He came from the original fish hatchery nest here 6 years ago. Yes, he's 6 now. I think I lost a year somewhere. Yeah, he's 7 already. That means I'm also 7 years old. And so he maybe fledged a little early, was doing some low flying. The best we can guess is that he got hit by a car from the side. And a few days later was found in one of the creeks here on the hatchery property. And so Bob Anderson, of course, waded in and grabbed him without gloves. And Cynthia Hansen transported to us, and he had a very high humerus fracture, an oblique fracture through this bone, and this side of the bone was on the wrong side. And so our surgeon in Spirit Lake, Dr. Dirks, did a pin and got everything in place, but in the process of healing, the shoulder joint is impacted, and so he can't do this. So he even can't quite do this. And so we're also suspecting there's a nerve that runs up here along the shoulder and the collarbone area, that nerve was somehow impacted too. So he's not a flyer. He cannot be released back into the wild. And he's on our education staff. He also had a very nice cut across his little eagle butt, and it had gotten maggots in it. And that's what rehabilitators love, is picking maggots out of wounds. And so we now have a really nice medication that will kill them, which is much more fun than picking. But at that point, we were just getting them out of him and letting that heal. But that did impact his tail and his tail feathers, because they're seeking blood, and so they were going down the shaft of his tail feathers. He still has blood feathers yet in his tail. So he does not have a complete set of 10. all there, he has seven. And right before, I think about a week ago, he molted all of them but three.
Oh.
So he has three children and one is black. So I don't know. I know you guys are going to ask, but I have zero answers for what's going on with his tail.
White stripes?
Yeah, maybe it's something with the age, but I don't know why he went. Because he was white and then he went back to black on that tail. So I'm going to get him out. We'll put him on the perch and we'll give you some more detail. On his nair either, so that's just gonna have to stay there because he'll bite my finger. Yes. And so the eye, we just noticed this when we were kind of practicing for this program. The eye on my side is looking just a little cloudy. Like he may have also had some sort of a partially detached retina in that accident. So we might have our vet. He seems to be seeing fine. It's not very yellow, but his teeth are still pretty brown, and he's getting kind of older, so I'm kind of expecting them to lighten up here a little bit. Eagles and lead poisoning. You guys did positive 35 this year. that that was found dead. Had a transmitter on, and Raptor Resource was able to walk in and find him. Was it a HER? D35 or HER?
HER.
And so we ended up doing necropsy, x-rayed her first, and so as part of our research, we are looking at what causes problems for eagles in the wild. And basically that's what rehabilitation does too. All of the animals that come to us and report, did they get hit by a car? You know, were they young of the year that were to try to record morbidity and mortality, basically. And that helps us because sometimes there are things where we can do just some little changes in our behavior that will greatly help the wild animals that are out there. And so eagles and lead poisoning fall directly into that category. We're not going to do a lot about cars and, you know, accidents and things like that. And you guys have done a wonderful job around here with the power line issue and keeping those sorts of things safe. So there's some things that we really can't impact, there's other things that we can. And so since 2004, SOAR has been collecting data on eagles that come into us. I think we're up to, Dana, was it like 600 in that database now?
653.
My number person. So that we just put this stuff all together. We're hoping to present at a conference for the Peregrine Fund out in Boise, Idaho this fall. So 653 eagles that have come to SOAR in the past 17 years. We have lead tests on most of those birds. Lead poisoning is still the number one cause for us seeing bald eagles coming in for rehabilitation. That's the number one cause of admission or morbidity mortality. Second is our trauma cases, our accidental broken bones, bruises, bumps, bruises, those sorts of things. Trauma comes in second. Everything else trails way down. The incidence of eagles being illegally shot. Yeah, so I think we're at maybe 10%, 8%, and we're still at about 40% with poisoning. And some of the ones that have been shot also have lead poisoning. So lead poisoning seems to be almost a predisposition for you running into trauma or a wind turbine or something like that. So the wind turbine numbers are, if I had a bar graph, lead, wind, would be way down here. I think this year we are in 2020, we have 4 wind cases and, you know, way over 20 lead. So that's still kind of the number one thing that we've been working on. And go to SOAR's webpage. There's great information on the webpage. Feel free to grab handouts here, copy things off the webpage, talk to whoever you can. That's really where we're at with this. If you know anyone that wants to hunt, it is an ammunition source, as we found with D35. He's just not gonna. Yeah, he practiced all week in the yard, and yes, of course, we caught them for 3. He did great. And now today,
he's just gonna turn around and circle
back. Mom and Dad, I'm home.
Yeah.
I'm here to visit.
So with D35, back to our necropsy stuff, the first thing we do is x-ray. And if there's any lead, if the animal has been shot, we will be able to see it. If it has ingested ammunition, we will be able to see it in an x-ray. So D35 came back, no broken bones, perfect looking skeleton, but we could see a lead metallic shot in his stomach because, yes, we must prove that it is lead. So guess what we do? We cut him open, and that's part of, we have a permit from Fish and Wildlife Service to do necropsies on eagles so we can continue this research. Find the lead shot, determine that it is lead and not steel. So that's what happened to D35. And so John and I were talking, and the timing would have been, could have been a pheasant. He's like, I'm just going to take off.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, a free stand. It could have been scavenged a pheasant, maybe a squirrel, some sort of small game animal, which is what you would be shooting with if they were number 6s or 7s.
Could have been turkey, too.
Could have been turkey. Yep. And so
Yeah. So it's still out there. We're still seeing it. We're still seeing the poisoning about the same numbers as we did when we started to contract. So more things to go on. One really encouraging thing. One really encouraging thing is that in Iowa, every county has a county conservation board. So they're like a miniature DNR. And in the state of Iowa, there's 99 counties, so the 99 county conservation boards manage more hunting grounds than our state agency, than our Department of Natural Resources. So if we could get all 99 counties to require non-lead ammunition on all of their hunting areas, huge. So we have gotten their people have gone, and they're run by a citizen board. So it's somebody's neighbor. And so people are able to more informally discuss what's going on and talk about how things are going. So one of the bigger counties that has switched all over, like, that's not the perch, exact perch that we used this week. This is a little different perch, but same color. Yeah, I don't know. So he's pretty much whatever he wants is usually what we do. But Story County, where Ames is, 2 years ago now, maybe three, they require non-lead ammunition on all of their hunting areas. So that would cover deer hunting, any kind of hunting non-lead. The first year, the rangers were not going to be really hardball about enforcing red warnings. They were going to do some education. And then after that, it might come up. But they have had no problems. No one has thrown a huge fit. They seem to have some decent compliance, and they're checking every so often. So it's just the idea of getting people over this last little hump of going there, and it's fine, and the sky didn't fall, and it's all good. So.
Is there any nationwide effort or maybe coordinated effort to provide similar regulations in other states or even federally to either, you could do it several ways, do an outright prohibition or taxing the heck out of is there anything that's more?
So California, 2019, I think they had a 5-year phase-in. And so, because they have condors, they have California condors that are even more highly susceptible than our eagles because they scavenge year-round. And those guys shoot feral pigs in California year-round. And so they really had a setup there for disaster with the condors. And so California's gone all non-lead for all their hunting. Again, seems to be working fine. I have not heard of another state that's done it that blanketly. I think the states are kind of doing little hodgepodge. In Iowa, if you're near water, you need to use non-toxic shot. But that's about as far as they've gone with some of it. So federally, the Fish and Wildlife Service, the very last days of the Obama administration, the Department of the Interior made a rule that on all federal lands, they were going to require non-lead ammunition. And then when the administration changed, that rule went away. And so the next step would be, now can it come back? Maybe. And so we will see. And so maybe contacting the Department of the Interior and asking for that rule back would be a really fun. Or it was a director's order. And I bet Lynette has it on our webpage somewhere.
If you search for it, you'll find it.
So that would be something that everyone could do, is send a little email and attach that and ask for it to come back. Because that would really lead the way. Like you're saying, if it were something federal, people that want to hunt on national wildlife refuges, they would have to abide by that. And then they go, well, if we're all geared up, we'll just keep doing it wherever we go hunting.
Are there any conservation organizations, big ones, that have come out that are working on this issue?
I think all of those have some little thread, you know, that they might incorporate into their, I think Audubon has been doing some things, American Bird Conservancy has been doing some things. So I think all of those conservation groups recognize this, and it's probably a little thread within their big envelope. So we're still working on that. That's kind of our resource, or our research piece. Doing our programs with it. So, any more eagle information?
Yeah, we'll talk all about eagle nesting and natural detection.
That's stuff that you guys already all know, but usually with the kids, we'll go through that, because a lot of them don't realize they grew up with eagles, and in Iowa, we are so fortunate because we have thousands of eagles that come to visit us in the wintertime. We're kind of like this eagle mecca, and so it's kind of gotten to the point where, I saw 10 of them out in the field the other day, like, not a big deal. And it's helpful to remind them. I grew up in Minnesota in the 60s when eagles were on the endangered species list. And even in Minnesota, it would like make the papers that somebody saw an eagle. And so for them to have come back, they were, during the very low point, we had 500 nesting pairs in the whole lower 48 states. You don't count Alaska, because that's kind of off by itself up there. And they attribute that to, and in Iowa, we lost eagles as a nester in the early 1900s because there were no rules. And if you wanted to shoot an eagle in 1900, you could shoot one, and you could chop their nest tree down, and you could kill the babies. And so in Iowa, they were seen as big predators that were competition, and they were not wanted. And so in Iowa, the white settlers got rid of the wolves and the bears and the bobcat and anything that might eat something. And the eagles kind of fell into that same category. And we were gone as nesters here, 1906, something like that. And then the rest of the country, the big impact was from DDT. The insecticide that impacts how their reproduction goes. And that's and so that was kind of the final, like the honeybees in the game, well, the big collapse was this and this and this and this. It wasn't one thing. It was probably a multiple of factors that kind of caused them to fall off the cliff and go into that deep dive and be put on the endangered species list. Captive breeding and reintroduction and protection of night roots and love that protect them from being shot, protect their nests, all of those things, and getting rid of DDT, all of this, and hopefully being more careful with insecticides in the future, all of those things have combined together, and people loving eagles.